fake my way through just about anything. Public speaking, check. Crying on cue, check. That one that you're all thinking about right now, check. Make most people believe that I've got my shit together? Check. But there are two things that I cannot fake my way through. Mathematics and motherhood. I try to do those math speed drills that the kids bring home. It's first grade in math. I don't beat the clock. I mean, ever. There's numbers swirling around in my head, and I'm drowning in motherhood and numbers. My sweet little five-year-old, the empath who believes that no one is bad, just merely misunderstood, is testing his own philosophy today in class. I'm a classroom volunteer, and so I turn to his teacher, who, despite her cold look, is incredible with the kids and also has impeccable style, and I ask, is he acting crazy today because I'm here? The crazy? No, this is all the time. We need a conference. What? I remember years ago when I was a theater arts teacher, long before pregnancy, holding only one conference in 10 years of teaching. Over the course of a year, I would teach 2,100 kids. And during my last year, I had a special conference regarding behavior with one student. His name was Angel. And he wasn't. But now it's my kid, and I'm threatening taking away screen time and sugar again, and I'm trying to be present with him when all I would rather do is sink into social media and not hear about the fact that poopy butts are funny and 2 times 4 is 8. Wait, what? 2 times 4 is 8. They're the 8 planets, Mommy. 2, 4, 6, 8. 2 times 4 is 8. You can't say your R's, but you can multiply. Okay. Wow, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna put down my phone and I'm going to focus on you, okay? We're going to bake cupcakes for your brother's 7th birthday party. I've invited way too many people. So we're gonna bake about 51 gluten-free chocolate cupcakes just to be on the safe side. I know you love to bake. 1/4 cup of oil, 2 eggs. 1.5 cups of sugar, we got this. Fractions, math, numbers. So the next day, as I'm frosting each one of these 51 morsels of delight, I get one cramp. It's intense, and I think, oh wow, this period's gonna be a doozy. More cramps, 2, 3, 4 more. I feel as if I'm going into labor, except I'm not pregnant, I don't think. Is it just gas? Did I eat too many cupcakes last night in that first batch, you know, to make sure they weren't poison? I take 2 Pepto-Bismol tablets and I lie down just for a minute. I calculate if I go to the ER now, I can make it back in time for the party if it's just gas. God, it's so embarrassing to go to the ER for gas. So my mom and I end up leaving. And we leave my husband to throw a party for 51 attendees who all happen to be my friends. And as we take off, I vomit, and it's clear that this is a bigger problem than I initially thought. I have never done my Kegels. I mean, as in, yeah, the Kegels. Never. And so every time I vomit, I drench piss my pants. I'm in the ER waiting room for 3.5 hours. In the first hour, I try lying down on the ground, but the security wants me in a seat. It's not sanitary on the floor, after all. Who cares? I'm a mom. I am used to grossness. I've already vomited and peed on myself. It shouldn't matter. By the second hour, the sea of people shifts every time I heave and they attempt to get as far away from me as humanly possible, and I don't blame them. My mom is almost cradling me and as patient as I've ever seen this human being who actually lives her life in juxtaposition to peace and calm. She continues to check in with the front desk every 20 minutes, then every 10, worried about her baby. By the third hour, I realize that the party is coming to an end at home, and I whisper, call James. Call James and tell him, don't let anybody eat those cupcakes. Throw them away. I might have norovirus. I find out through speakerphone that my neighbor actually plans to stow some away in her Tupperware, claiming that she didn't care if they were diseased, they looked too good to throw away. I have momentary Pinterest mom pride amidst my sickening groans and wails. After 3.5 hours of waiting, we are finally wheeled into the ER private room where I can lie down on the bed. Dr. Gorgeous, it's not his real name, but he walks in to examine me. There I am, lying in my own urine-soaked sweats, and the vision of handsome arrives to save the day. I'm not thrilled. After 30 minutes of countless ultrasound pics and one CAT scan, Doc Guapo announces that I need to be wheeled immediately into emergency surgery. And there it was. After 5 hours and 4 doctors, 2 nurses, 1 patient, and 1 mom, we found the culprit. 1 popcorn kernel. Mm-hmm. 1 perforation of 1 colon, and level 10 on the pain chart. In less than an hour, I was under anesthesia, and they were surgically removing it, and reassuring me with their eyes rolling that I wouldn't need a poop bag for the rest of my life. The kids came to visit a couple days later, and my eldest handed me a sweet handwritten card, but the little one just eyed me and circled my bed, singing Imagine Dragons, thunder, thunder. He's so weird. He stopped to count the bags of saline and antibiotics hanging next to my bed. There's 8 to be exact. Apparently, he was having a horrible time in school and acting out like crazy. My God, I am the parent with the problem kid, and I can't do anything from this hospital bed. And then one night while I was stuck in the hospital, he asked Grandma if I was going to die. I hadn't personally really thought about it because I hadn't thought about death. I was too busy and my life was too packed. I was told that after he asked, he didn't wait for an answer. He just threw himself in my mom's arms and sobbed. I don't want my mommy to die. This kid needed his mother, and I needed to be near him to get him through the challenges and hurdles of school and life. And so that first night I was home, I lay on the side that didn't hurt. I held him close, and I talked about life, the good, the bad, not so bad, the sometimes ugly. 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 plus 2 is 4. We have 4 in our family, and no one is going anywhere for a long time. I promise. Hoping and wishing that I am right. It's been 6 months since my hospital stay, and every once in a while, the 5-year-old asks the same question. You won't die soon, will you? I mean, not for a long, long time. I don't understand time, kid. It's all math to me. I don't understand what happens when we go. I don't understand quantum physics, the universe, or God. But I understand love. And I promise I will love you forever. And forever is. He chimes in. Infinity numbers? Yeah. Too many to count.